the entity had destroyed my mother-in-law's room upstairs to the extent, and it was so, it was felt so dangerous now, we all moved in together into the master suite downstairs.
Huddling together.
Yeah, so now downstairs we have, and thank goodness it's a really large room, has a sitting room, so we had beds in there, and we had bed in the other part, so we all stayed together. At night, we didn't go apart. My mother-in-law very rarely even walked through the house by herself.
Don't blame you a bit.
No,
I think any group of people would be so terrorized. Yes, you can do nothing. There is nothing, literally, you can do. So you try to survive.
Right. That's what you do. You try to survive the best you can. It got to the point where she'd be sitting in a chair. She'd turn next door, and next door would be a knife sticking right next to her in the wall.
Oh, my God.
And these weren't our knives. We ended up with a box of knives, a big box of knives that weren't our knives that we just threw away.
Really?
He just supported them here.
So you saved them.
We had them in a box, and we threw them away after about a year when the box got filled. We just threw them away.
You had a box full of knives.
Yeah, and they weren't our knives. And they were all kinds of knives, old knives, new knives.
So at this point, you had no idea. You were in discussions with this thing, right? I mean, obviously.
Up to a point, we weren't, because in a way, like I said at the beginning, for the first year or so, he talked at us. He wouldn't really communicate with us. Later on, he started communicating with me. But at this point, he wasn't. Like, the last thing was, like, before the spear came. I'll talk to you about the spear. But before they came, the Indians came. The shamans came.
Indians?
Yeah,
okay.
Shamans. Very nice people. They really tried to help us. There were two shamans came, a female and a male. And I went with them upstairs. Now, no one was upstairs. The entity took over the upstairs. It became his upstairs.
Okay.
You could feel it if you start going up the steps. You'd get halfway up the steps, and it was like something would just tell you no, and you'd want to come back down the steps. You just left it alone. So we didn't use the upstairs for like 6 years.
Lord.
He went, the two shamans went upstairs. They asked me to come with them. I went with them. They did a ritual. They had feathers, and they were putting sage, I think, all through the rooms and chanting. They opened up the door, which is right at the top of the steps that goes into the attic. They opened up the door, and they would blow the sage in. And as they would blow the sage in, a second later, something would blow it back out.
And so their reaction?
Yeah, you could see the smoke go in, then you could see something blow it out again.
And their reaction to that?
They said, we have to go into that room.
Okay.
So they went into the attic. I stood right at the doorway so I could be right there seeing what was going on. Now, the attic had a pink insulation around the walls. And he told me he was going to confront this and make it show itself. I stood right there and watched this happen. And it's something I'll remember to my dying day. As I watched, the pink insulation came off the sides of the wall and formed into a gigantic head. It was like a 5-foot head hanging from a rafter. And it was just a head, that was all, and I only saw the side view of it. I didn't see the front. And it had a huge chin and a large nose, and on the side of its head, instead of an ear,
yes,
it had a circular horn that started there and made a circle and went up and over the top of its head into a big horn.
How are you taking this, Debbie? Even the unaverage person could not take this kind of stuff happening.
You know, this is the truth. I don't know why, but from the very beginning, I was not frightened of this. It was almost like one of us in the house had to be the strong one. My husband couldn't. He had a bad heart. My father-in-law wasn't a good person. My mother-in-law was weak, and I had a child. Someone had to defend the family, and it was left to me. So
right.
I just, that
right.
was it.
All right, Deborah Moffitt, hold on. The head part, that would have been over the top. Way, way, way over the top for me. I'm Art Bell. This is Midnight in the Desert. Tell you all about the mouse in a moment. Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable.
Set in the dark, stays in the dark. Call Midnight in the Desert at 1-952-CALL-ART. That's 1-952-225-5278.
All right, my guest is Deborah Moffitt. She's in a nightmare nobody can even contemplate. We're only partway through the story. It's just, it's off the charts, totally off the charts, as you can hear. I want to take a second because I've never had anything like this happen before. Now, I'm telling you, you heard me when it happened. I just took a picture, and I sent it to Keith. Now, it's not of the mouse because the mouse is vanished, gone. Here's the way it came down, and it's just too weird. I mean, on my right, literally, on my right is a Denon CD player, right? And above that, I've got a special Denon machine that plays Keith's voice. Get the evil Keith on my mind. We'll play Ross's voice.
Feel free to.
You know, like that. When I hit a button. That's where the mouse was standing. Now, that's directly in front of me. Right next to me. And this mouse is sitting there, eyes open, looking at me. Curious. Or something. I mean, why would a mouse get that close to a human and then just sit there and stare? I turned to my left to get my camera, and, you know, I started to open the camera app, and I turned back around and it was gone. That was freaky. Let me tell you, that was freaky. That mouse I'm going to name Abby. I need to do something with the name Abby. Oh, God, I wonder where it is. What was weird about it is, A, it was so close to me. B, it could have set off Ross's voice. It was just standing there. And C, it was staring at me. I'm telling you. I looked it right in the eyes. It looked at me. I know. Too much, right? But it happened, and I had to get that off my chest. So anyway, I sent a picture to Keith of the equipment I'm talking about, and he's going to post it up there, I think. So you can take a look. You'll see how close this is to me. It's right here. I could have, well, if I'd been fast and had the guts, I could have grabbed him with my hand. That's how close he was. But the little sucker was staring at me. All right. Gathering back together. It's just weird. It's weird that it happens when I'm getting a story like this from Debbie. Hey, Debbie.
Yes.
I mean, that's almost impossible. There's, you know, a mouse.
Strange.
Yeah, they're pretty, you know.
Timid.
Timid and scattered. This guy was, I could have grabbed him with my hand. That's how close he was, and just staring at me. Weird. Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to your weirdness. So, this thing is ruining your life. It's ruining your house. Literally destroying your house. It's putting knives hither and yon. In places where you might sit, God, that awful thought. And there's no help to be had, no matter who you see.
We tried everything. It got to the point where my mother-in-law was becoming distraught, which you couldn't blame her. She had no life. She couldn't even have a money to do anything.
Right.
You know, I believe that this entity, whatever it was, and I still to this day don't really know what it was. I don't think it had the power to actually kill her. I think it wanted her to commit suicide. And that was trying to drive her to suicide. Because with the power it had, I can't believe it couldn't just snap her neck if it wanted to.
That's a very good point. It seems like it was trying to either scare her to death or, as you point out, have her take her own life.
Right.
Now,
when they moved downstairs with us in the master bedroom, the entity no longer wrote upstairs because no one was up there to see it.
Right.
It started writing in the guest bathroom downstairs. So it moved from upstairs to downstairs, not living, but writing.
Right.
So that's where it did all its writing. And it wouldn't write a little bit. It would write morning, noon, and night, constantly writing.
Examples, please, of what it said.
It would, like I said, at first it would tell us what to do. How it changed was like this. This was after like 2 years of going through this constant terror, especially with my mother-in-law. And it got to the point it was just too much. Then something happened. The entity locked her in the pantry. She got up to get some paper towels. It locked her in the pantry. And it did grab her by the throat and throttled her. Now, like I said, with its strength and its power, it could have killed her if it wanted to, but it didn't. But it did leave marks on her throat. At that time, it just got to the point where I felt so helpless. Because what can you do? I was trying to protect her the best I could, but how can you fight at something you can't see? So I went into the mirror at this time. I was very angry with the entity. And I confronted it, and I told it, I said, listen, I'm going to treat you with respect. You'll treat me with respect. You're not to touch my child, my husband, or my mother-in-law, Lee. Mm. And I left the bathroom to see what it was going to say. A minute later, I walked back in, and it wrote on the mirror, I will not touch the child. I will not touch your husband, but Lee belongs to me. That's when it told me, when I asked it why,
finally.
That's when it wrote the story of what happened in the past and why she belonged to him.
Well, wait a minute. It wrote the whole story?
Yes. It took an hour. I would go in. He'd write on the mirror. I'd erase it. I'd go back out, come back in. He told the whole story.
Oh, Debbie, I don't get how you held up through this.
You know what? It's because I didn't have a choice.
Well,
what
okay.
Can I do?
Yeah, I do get that. I guess I get that. But when I say held up, I meant psychologically held up. How did you not go bonkers?
Because I was so worried about everybody else and making sure they were safe and trying to appease the entity at the same time. Because I found out from that time on, that's when I started calling the entity Mr. Entity. I wouldn't call it Prince because I wouldn't give it that power over me to call it Prince because that's what it wanted. So I couldn't call it Entity. So I just called it, I told it I'd treat it with respect, and it sounds silly, but I started calling it Mr. Entity. From that time on, I referred to him as Mr. Entity, and he would call me Debbie. And from that time on, instead of talking at us, he started to actually communicate with me. He would write to me on the mirror.
Did you get any photographs of all this?
This is funny. When it first started, we'd had one researcher come, and he would say, now take pictures of everything that happens and document everything so that you can show the next researcher or you can show me what's happening.
Yes.
So we would. It'd write on the mirror, we write it in a book, and we try to take pictures. Now, some of the pictures aren't great because you have to remember back at that time, it wasn't the digital camera where you could see if you took a good picture.
Right.
And taking pictures of a mirror, you got a lot of glare.
Right. Right, I get that, but you did.
Okay.
You did
so
take pictures.
During this whole, like, 6-year period, we must have taken 1,000 pictures.
Okay.
Right? But this is what would happen. The next researcher that would come would say to us, now, you got to get rid of all these pictures. You got to get rid of all this documentation because you're keeping it here. You're acknowledging it and you're making it stay. So throw all this away. So it was a constant taking pictures, throwing them away, taking pictures, throwing them away. So luckily, my husband, who was a hoarder, he would not throw them all away. He had a box, which I didn't know about until he died. He would take some of the pictures, and he'd throw them all the time in the box. So I have like over 200 pictures, 250 pictures of the demon writing and the things that happened with the negatives. So I have a box full of those, but they're not all the pictures because we threw most of them away.
Yeah, but it would be enough.
Yeah.
It would be
that's
enough.
In the book, The Unwelcome. That's why I actually wrote the second book. Because the second book, actually, I just wanted to show people the pictures. There's over 100 pictures in that book of what went on. And that's what's so fascinating. Even me, who went through it. See, for 25 years, we hid it because once it left, we decided we're not going to talk about it because people said, well, don't talk about it because you'll bring it back. So we didn't want it to come back. So we never, for 25 years, we made a vow. We never spoke to a person about it. No one ever knew anything about it. Even my kids didn't know about it.
You said, you indicated that something strange happened. Well, go ahead. Your husband died?
My husband died, and I was cleaning out the closet, and I found the box in the back of the closet.
Right.
And I opened it up, and it was full of the pictures from the demon.
Okay, and those are in your book?
Yeah. Just 100 of them. I have 100s more.
You have 100 pictures in the book. That's pretty darn good, I'd say.
Yeah, I wanted people to see it. I wanted people to realize that, you know, this happened. Look what it did. Look how it communicated.
Your books are a deadly haunting and unwelcome.
Now, the deadly haunting is the fiction version. It's based on the true story, but it's more fictionalized. But 95% of it's accurate.
Okay.
I wrote unwelcome because I wanted everything to be the truth. I wanted people to know just what happened, and I wanted to show the pictures.
All right. Now, you indicate that something happened involving animals. What was that?
Oh, this is very sad for me to talk about because the entity killed our animals. When we left the first houses down on the other street, we left our dog down there the last night. We were going to pick him up in the morning because we had no place to put him.
Right.
And we had wrought iron gates. And the entity took the dog, and he actually pulled the dog, a pit bull, big, heavy pit bull. It actually pulled it through one of the 3-4-inch wrought iron slot.
Oh, my God.
So half the dog was on one side and half was on the other.
Oh, my God.
And I could cry when I even think about it, that why we left that dog there. I remember saying, please, let's take him. No, he'll be okay one night. We'll pick him up tomorrow. And he wasn't. It's so sad. It was just...
All right, you did contact Ed and Lorraine Warren, right?
Right. I contacted Ed and Lorraine Warren.
What did they do?
They were very nice people. They came out. This was back in, let's see, 88, I think. Or was it 89? The beginning of 89. It was in February of 89, I think it was.
Right.
They were very nice people. I contacted them. They said they were coming out to California to have some kind of convention or something with a friend of theirs. I think his name was Chuck Moses from Los Angeles.
Okay.
And so they said they would stop and try and see if they could help us. Ed Warren was, you could sit and talk to him for hours. He was such a very kind, nice man. Lorraine was a little different. She's a little standoffish, a little reserved, but they were both very nice. I remember they came into the house. Now, whenever the entity did something, very few times did you actually ever get to see it. It's like you had to turn your back or blink an eye before it happened. And this is one of the things I actually saw. When Lorraine came into the room, she walked by a toy box, and the toy box slid right out in front of her. So I actually saw that. And that was one of the rare times it did something in front of someone.
Okay. So the Warrens tried, but no luck.
They came. We all sat down. She said, I'm going to walk through the house. She walked through the house. She came back down. She was rather pale, and I remember she looked at us and said, "This demon is the most powerful, ancient, evil demon I have ever experienced." She said, "This is bad." I remember turning dead and saying, "This is bad, Ed. This is really bad." Of course, my mother-in-law almost passed out when she heard this because it really scared her. They told us they didn't have any contacts in California, someone who could come and help us other than them.
Right.
And so they decided, Ed said he would do a rite of provocation.
Oh, I don't know what that is.
I really don't know either. It's just he kind of confronted the demon. But,
okay.
You know, at the time, I think there was more than one thing in the house. Because you got the feeling there was one strong thing and maybe some other things that weren't quite as powerful, but there was like one main thing that was the mean bad one. And I remember they went in and we all sat in a circle. And at the time we had a researcher staying with us whose name was Gary, who was brought to us by a friend who became a good friend of ours, Brian Hurst. Mm-hmm. He tried to help us. He was a medium in Los Angeles, a quite famous medium. He tried to help us. He wouldn't go into trance in the house because he said it was just too dangerous, but he did try to get people to come and help us, and he brought Gary. Gary was a researcher. He was staying with us, and the entity just hated Gary. He would torment Gary as much as he tormented my mother-in-law. So we sat in the circle, and Ed and Lorraine brought a gentleman, I think his name was Kevin, who videotaped everything. He videotaped it. And I remember we were sitting in the living room, and Ed did prayers, and he did some other kinds of things, and then he called forth the demon. Now, my father-in-law was sitting right next to me, and I remember my father-in-law started to change. Excuse me. I don't mean literally change into a monster, but there was subtle changes. His arm curled up to his chest. His back started to bend forward, so he kind of leaned forward.
Wow.
And he kind of became something different than what he was. And he stood up, and he walked towards Ed, and he dragged his one leg, and he went towards Ed. And when Ed saw him coming towards him, he got frightened, and he held up a little piece of wood he had, and he said, "This is a holy relic from the cross. You can't harm me." And my father-in-law, in a voice that was completely different than his, but his voice, said, "I'm going to bite your hand off and take your hand in that wood and chew it up and spit it in your face." And then all of a sudden, my father-in-law turned around, walked back in the couch, sat down on the couch, and went back to normal.
This is a horror movie.
It is. It's like anything that ever, I mean, we had, you know, I don't mention the things like the smells and the pounding and the banging, because they seem so non-consequential compared to the other things that happened.
Right, right.
But we had all that. We had, like, for 2 weeks, we had, like, rats infesting. I mean, they were so bad that in the pantry, you'd open the door, and they'd be hanging upside down, swinging in the pantry.
Really?
We had birds for over a week that would bombard our windows in the bedroom.
I wish you hadn't told the rat story. I'm still looking for that thing.
Yeah, we had rats.
Wonderful. Rats. Hanging upside down.
Hanging upside down, just swinging. I mean, and they wouldn't move. You'd go in and you'd look at them, and they'd just look at you. I mean, it was like they weren't afraid of you.
Now you're scaring me, Debbie, because you're doing this on purpose, aren't you?
So Mr. Entity, I remember asking Mr. Entity. It got to the point when I would communicate. It got to, if I communicated with Mr. Entity,
yes,
and he loved to talk, I would go in and talk to him all the time. If I talked to him, he wouldn't be as destructive. It's like he was using his energy to communicate instead of destroy the house.
Now, you're really serious about the rats just staring at you?
I swear to you, they just would stare at you. They wouldn't run. They just look at you. And we'd have to back. I remember backing out of the pantry with Ma, and we'd say, "Oh, my God." And then, you know, my father-in-law said, don't worry. He said, I'll go get rat poison. And Mr. Entity wrote on the mirror, "If you get rat poison, not only the rats will get the poison."
Oh, my God.
See, this is what he did. He would threaten us, but then he would back up his threats. He wanted us to bring a gentleman here who had come to the house before, who he said he had known in a past life. And he said if we didn't bring him, something bad would happen. Well, we didn't want to bring this gentleman back to the house. You know, it wasn't the type of person we wanted to bring back to the house.
Yeah.
So he killed another dog. So, see, that's what he did. He just, what could we do? How can you fight that? You can't fight something you can't see. There was no one to help us. It was just a matter of surviving. Our life became so bizarre. It was like what was abnormal to someone else would be normal to us. Getting up, looking for knives, pulling knives out of the wall. I mean, we got to the point where we would just do it. It's like it wouldn't frighten us anymore because it became so part of our life.
Well, now you're starting to scare me a little bit. Here I am listening to your story. I'm 70 years old, Debbie.
Mm-hmm.
70. A mouse does not come up 2 feet away from you, and that's how close this mouse was. I took a photograph, by the way, and sent it to Keith. So if you want to see how close it is to me, it's the device that allows me to play Ross Mitchell. This mouse, if he had put his foot forward just a hair, would have set off one of those and played Ross Mitchell.
Mm-hmm.
That's how close it was. But what got to me was a little guy sat there and just stared at me.
Right. It's like they're not afraid of you. It's like they're almost just staring you down.
Well, yes, that's never happened in my 70 years, Debbie. And here you are telling this story tonight, and you get to rats staring at you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're freaking me out a little bit now. when we come back, I want to sort of finish up, and then I want to begin to take some calls. Would you mind doing that?
Oh, certainly. I'd enjoy it.
All right. What a night this has been. And if she had not come to the story on the rats, I would have been, I'd be feeling a lot better right now. I'm telling you, I've never had anything like that happen in my life. You know, they run. They should be afraid of us, right? This guy was staring straight at me. And that must have gone on for 10 to 15 seconds or so before I turned around to get the camera. You know, the iPhone 6 with the camera. Then he was gone. Shouldn't say he. I named her Abby, right? Ay-yi-yi. This is Midnight in the Desert.
A dialogue sequence with Art Bell, please coordinate your phalanges and call 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Well, okay. Cheers to the person who said, why don't we name that mouse Abby Normal? Yeah, thanks a lot. All right. My guest is... Staring rats, God. Deborah Moffitt. So, if you have questions for her, and I can imagine you would, I certainly do, and incidentally, you can go to my website, not only seeing a picture of where that mouse was, it's the little device with all the little white buttons. That's where the mouse was. And also, you can see some pictures that Deborah took. So, for all those reasons, go to my website now and click on a picture of my guest, Deborah Moffitt, and follow the links. Apparently, it'll go over to her website. There may be some pictures on my website. I'm not really sure. We're about to go to the phones, and I really do want your help in asking questions. This is a very, very long-term, significant haunting case or demon case. I guess a demon case, right? We'll talk more about that. Anyway, here's the talk. You're welcome to call now at area code 952-225-5278. That's area code 952-225-5278. You can reach us as well on Skype. North America, we are simply MITD51. Midnight in the Desert 51. MITD, just the letters. It's not case sensitive. You can make it anything you want. MITD51. If you're outside of North America, it's MITD55. MITD55. Once again, here is Debbie. Okay, Debbie, this is such an incredible, incredible story in every way I can think of. You then called, and you sort of gave us a story. Dr. Paglini, and a lot of people on right. This show have a lot of respect for Dr. Paglini, the late great Dr. Paglini.
Like I said, she was just awesome.
I had her on the show many times.
Yeah,
and
really
here's what I'll tell you. I had all kinds of seers on the show, Debbie. I had, you know, all kinds of psychics and people like that, trying to predict the future. Nobody even came close to being as accurate as Dr. Paglini. It was bizarre how accurate she was. So if she couldn't do it, I guess nothing could do it, and she did say she couldn't get this thing out, but she felt it.
Right. Well, like I said, when she came here, tried to get rid of it. Then she called up later, like within a week's time or so, and she had my father-in-law write things on the mirror for her. And she wrote Dr. Paglini blank and blank. And at the bottom of the one thing she had my father write, God protects us. And Mr. Entity crossed off God and put Prince protects us.
All right. There must have been a way that you finally got rid of this thing. What did you do?
First, let me tell you about the spear, because that is so...
Oh, that's right, the spear. Oh, God,
so
yes.
Amazing.
The spear.
That's something I still have today. one night, my father-in-law jumps out of bed, and he said, like something had touched him. And it was like 3 in the morning. We go over to his bed, and in his bed, he picks up a spearhead. It's about, 17 inches long. It's made of iron, some type of metal, looks like iron, and it's hand-forged. It's really old. And Mr. Entity writes on the mirror that he wants a blood sacrifice.
And provides a spear.
And the spear must be used. He wanted my father-in-law to use the spear on my mother-in-law because he had to have blood for his ritual.
Okay.
So the next day, I remember, I took possession of the spear because I knew if I had it, Mr. Entity never touched anything that belonged to me. He, for some reason, I think he respected me.
Apparently.
He just stayed away from me. If I was with my mother-in-law, he wouldn't harm her. If I was away from her, he harmed her. If I had something that belonged to me, it wasn't touched. I took the spear and I put it away because I knew if I had it, Mr. Entity couldn't have it. We took it to the next day to the Los Angeles History Museum, to see if we could have it identified.
Right. And?
The gentleman there, we got to go in the back with all the tables, and the gentleman came out and told us he looked at it, and he told us it was a spearhead from the Belgian Congo area.
Really?
It was over 200 years old.
Really?
And he said it looked like it was brand new. He couldn't understand it because it looked so new, like it was just made. And he said it wasn't for hunting, it wasn't for warfare because of the way it was sharpened, he could tell. He said this was a type of spearhead that's used for, the shamans use for magical rituals.
So, Debbie.
I remember when I came home and I asked Mr. Entity, where did you get this? He said, I got it from the Congo. But he told us it was a very special implement and that it had to be used for the blood ritual.
This was a very conversational demon.
It talked all the time. Matter of fact, I told it, no, you're not. I actually said, no, you're not getting a blood ritual. I'm not going to let it happen. And it got so upset, it blew out all the windows in the top floor.
Who did all the repairs?
My father-in-law and myself. I mean, we had a big tubs of plaster because he used to gouge in the wall. If you look at some of the pictures, you can see he used to just take something and gouge in the walls. That's why I was actually happy when he started writing on the mirror, because when he started writing on the mirror, he stopped gouging everything in the walls. I remember one of the researchers said to us, well, why are you letting him write on the mirror? Just take the soap away. Don't
right.
let him write on the mirror. And then I tried to explain to him, well, if we take the soap away, he destroys the house. It's best that he puts it on the mirror. We can wipe it off.
Right. Okay.
And also, if I communicated with him, he didn't, like I said, he wasn't after my mother-in-law, and he wasn't after the house every minute. It was like he used his energy to communicate, and he liked to communicate.
I can see now, for example, the front of your book, Unwelcomed, has what looks like a bloody, is that a spear?
That's the spear.
That's the spear.
Mm-hmm.
Looks like blood on it. Oh, my God, look at this. I can see a bed. Oh, my God, a bed standing on end. How does that happen?
He would take, no, this is strange. The room is a small room. It's a four-poster bed. Sometimes we'd come in and the bed would be upside down, and you had to take the bed apart to get it to be, put it back up because the bed's too big to turn over in the room.
Yeah.
So it would be upside down.
Upside down's bad enough, but this is like it's would have to be balanced to be in this position.
Yeah, it was. So, like I said, a few things happened in front of you.
Oh, you
most
did get
everything
pictures.
Happened behind your back.
Yeah.
One of the most, I think, amazing things, even more amazing than the spear and the ports and everything else, is two pictures I took in the bathroom. Now, you have to understand, their bathroom mirrors were bolted onto the wall.
Right.
They were never taken from the wall until I redecorated in 2013.
Right.
I would go in, take pictures, and then, you know, we'd look at the pictures. So I was going through the pictures looking for pictures to put in the book. And I see one picture, and then I see another picture that was taken. They have dates on them. That was taken right afterwards.
Yeah, I see the dates.
And you look at the picture, and it's not, the reflection is not the bathroom. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes.
If you look in the mirror, you see the reflections behind you.
That's the wrong thing. Yes, it's the wrong thing.
It's the kitchen. I can see the kitchen.
I don't know how you could have put up with this. I really don't.
We had no choice.
Yeah, I'm getting that.
What could we do? We couldn't run away from it. We couldn't get rid of it. No one could help us. We just had to survive.
Right. There came a time, I guess, when you finally got rid of this thing?
Yeah, it left of its own free will.
Why? I mean, it had an absolute goal, right?
Right. Here's what happened. Dr. Baglini, like I told you, she told us how powerful this was.
Yes.
But she said to me, she said, listen, the reason I can't get rid of this is because somebody in the house is giving it permission to stay. And if someone gives it permission to stay in the house,
uh-huh.
no one can get rid of it. She said, I'm not telling you I can get rid of it even if that person leaves. She said, but we have a better chance. So she said, I said, well, who is it? She said, we'll find out tonight. She said, I'm going to do something. She said, tomorrow you call me and you let me know what happens tomorrow night.
Yes.
Okay, during the middle of the night, I think it was like 3:30 or so, my father-in-law jumps up in bed and he starts coughing like he can't breathe.
Right.
Just coughing and coughing.
Right.
And shaking. And we thought we were going to have to call the ambulance because he wouldn't stop. Then, just like it started, he laid back down and went right back to sleep, like nothing happened. So the next day, I told Dr. Baglini what happened, and she said, he's the one that's giving it permission to stay in the house. And I found out the entity actually wrote to me and explained to me that my father-in-law was not a very nice man, not a nice man at all. And he had got to the point he was sick of my mother-in-law. And so he was actually encouraging the entity to kill my mother-in-law. So when the entity explained this to me, then not only did I have to protect her from the entity, but I had to protect her from her husband. And she was one of these old-world Italian ladies. We would say to her, Ma, you got to get rid of him. He's got to go, or we can't get rid of the entity. Oh, no, it's not him. It's not him. We even sent him to a psychiatrist, everything, to try to find out if the hostility he had towards my mother-in-law. Nothing helped. Finally, she made him move out. When he moved out, the entity didn't leave. The entity still stayed. But he became more community. He liked to talk even more when my father-in-law was gone. Once my father-in-law was gone, and I knew nothing was keeping him in the house, and Gary was still living with us at the time, I remember telling Mr. Entity, you have to go now, Mr. Entity. No one's keeping you here, and you're not going to stay here. Gary, who was a researcher, who was kind of down on his luck, he decided because the entity was so powerful that if he welcomed him into his life, maybe his life would be better. So Gary told me, he said, I'm going to go in, and I'm going to tell Mr. Entity he can come with me. I'm leaving. I'm going to England. He can come with me.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember I went in and I told Mr. Entity, all right, Mr. Entity, it's time for you to leave now. You have to go. Gary said you can go with him. And the entity wrote on the mirror, I don't want to leave. And then he wrote, I will not work with an inferior being.
Mm-hmm.
I will destroy him.
Okay. I'm going to go to some calls. This story did a pretty good job on me tonight. Hi there. I think Orleans, Ontario, maybe?
That's right. This is Kimmy J, and I want to send a shout-out to all my DM Talk peeps, especially to Michael and Rob. Hi, Art. Hi, Debbie.
Hi.
I have a question concerning EVPs, and I'd like to know if Debbie caught any and if she has any up on her website.
Do you know what? Back then, no one even brought up the subject of EVPs to us. We were novices in this. We were just fighting to stay alive. I didn't, if someone would have suggested it, I would have tried it, but no one even suggested it.
Yeah, and you didn't really need to hear voices. You had it all written out for you.
Right. He would write it.
Okay, perfect. Thanks a lot.
You're very welcome.
Bye.
Listen, folks, be sure you take a look at these photographs. The ones that are on my website, just down below, Deborah's picture, you'll see her books, and then you'll see this bed standing on end. When I mean on end, two legs, the other two legs clean up in the air. This was serious stuff. You'll see a picture of this spear. I guess that's what it is, a spear. How big was that?
It's about 17 inches.
Okay.
And it looks like it's made for ritual sacrifice of some kind.
Oh,
right. That's the entity told me what this sphere is possible, has the capability to do, and I won't even talk about it. I mean, I just keep it put away so it can't hurt anybody, because if the entity gets it again, I'm afraid he'll hurt somebody with it.
Are you afraid it's going to come back?
No.
Good. Robert, you're on the air with Debbie.
Chris, your story. I'm
very moved by it, too, but, Robert, I had to cut that out. I don't want you to give your last name on the air.
Oh, I'm sorry. I had no idea. My bad.
So, Robert.
Can I start again?
Yes.
Hello. I just wanted to say, Deborah's story, you've moved me, and we have a research group here, and we have gone through something very similar. We have found that it's the interaction between when the spirits or demons talk to you, and they, after the person, someone does need to give permission, but also anyone else, anyone sensitive who can hear them, it's the interaction that seems to give them energy. And the more you talk to them, the more they can affect you. There's so many people I found going through this now. I just wanted to let people know that. And the mouse thing, that when I was first in a house, when I first started being able to hear, I didn't believe what I was hearing. And it's like they wanted to prove it, and a mouse, a big rat, walked up and stared at me exactly when Art started saying what had happened to him. Chills just tore through my spine. This is like the fifth time I've heard this. The fact that it happened live to Art is just flabbergasting. And so that is, I'm very happy to hear that after that man left, after he was put out of the house, that the entity finally did leave. That at least I can tell some of the people here who are still suffering from that, that there is hope. They just have to. I wish I knew how your person that helped you made him cough so you could identify who in fact was giving permission. I would love to know how to do that. Is it a prayer? Is it a ritual? Or if you could elaborate on that, I would love it so much. Thank you.
When Gary told him he could go with him, Mr. Entity said, no, I'm not going. I want to stay here. And all I did was say, no, you're not staying here. You have to leave now. It's time for you to go. And he said, I won't work with an inferior being. And this is so strange, because for a demon, when he talked, he said, then he wrote, why? I said, well, why won't you go with Gary? He said he has no integrity, he has no word, and he gave like a list of things, and I thought, what a strange thing for a demon to demand from a person to leave with when he's a demon. Yet he expected the person that he left with to have like integrity. That was so strange.
Yeah, this whole night is strange. Let's go on to our next caller. You're on the air with Deborah. Hi.
Hey, how y'all doing? I just wanted to say that I find the subject of apports to be extremely interesting. That's the most interesting thing I've heard tonight. I just wanted to clarify with you, Debbie, there was no apparitions that have appeared during the situation?
My mother-in-law saw something twice. She saw blackness come after. It actually chased her down the hall. And she saw like the black, like a blackness. No, nothing with the eyes, no form, just black. She went after her twice when she was alone.
Like a shadow figure of some kind?
Actually, she said it wasn't even a figure. It was just blackness, like a black cloud. The only thing I said that I saw that resembled when it showed itself with the insulation.
Have you ever heard of the documentary, The Afterlife Investigations, either of you? There's a lot of afterlife.
No.
No.
Yeah, it's a study by Skoll. That was it was a British study of these sort of things. It's very interesting that I think both of you should check out. It's called The Afterlife Investigations, and one of the best documentaries I've ever seen dealing with apports and all kinds of different things.
All right. Well, I'll check it out to be sure. Do you remain interested in this sort of thing, Deborah, or do you want to put it behind you?
I still have an interest in it. I don't want to get involved in it because I just, you know, I've been there, done it. I just don't want it. But it's still very interesting. Why it's interesting to me is because I have so many unanswered questions. How things happened, why they happened, who this was. I would love someone to say, to research it and say, you know, this is what really happened. This is what it was. This is why it could do this. That I would love, because I just have no answers.
I get it. Okay, let's go to Twin Cities for Deborah. Hi.
Hi, Art. This is Rocky. I had a couple questions. One of them was answered. I was going to ask if she tried removing the soap, but I guess she answered that. I was wondering if the entity could kill animals, why she thinks that it couldn't actually harm any of the humans.
Because I believe that a human is a higher soul, and I don't think the demon could kill it. I think I think even demons have rules. That's my own belief. I don't know if it's true or not.
Demons have rules?
Yeah. I think that there's certainly everything has certain rules. And I really don't believe a demon can actually kill someone. I think they drive them to suicide, or they scare them to death, or they influence somebody else to hurt them.
Actually, that may be a pretty good point. Because rarely do you ever hear, but a dog torn in half, literally, I mean, my God.
It was horrible. Absolutely horrible.
Anything else, caller?
Seeing the image of the spear, it sort of reminded me of images of ancient relics about the spear of destiny, the spear that was used to pierce the side of Jesus.
It does look very ancient to me.
Yeah, there are different relics throughout history and that had claimed to be it. The one that I've seen images of, it was just the point of the spear, very similar to what she took a picture of.
Did you see the picture of the bed up above?
Yeah.
Yikes. This is the serious stuff that you see in horror movies. Really, it is. Okay, well, thank you, caller. You've written books. Do you think, Debbie, anybody biting on a movie?
You know what? I never even pursued that. My first goal was just being able to tell people what happened after so many years of hiding it. I just felt so good just telling people, look, this really happened. I mean, that was my first goal, just to get it out there, to let people know what happened, to be able to just tell people about it.
Yeah, I get it. That helps to be able to talk to people. There's no question about it.
It really did help.
All right. Let's go to Chase, I believe it is, on Skype. Hello.
Hello. How are you guys?
We're fine.
Good, thank you.
Great. Deborah, I wanted to ask you if you ever did any research on Prince, actually. I vaguely remember something about Solomon in the Old Testament working with some form of demon called Prince, or any kind of research on the triangle with the tail.
You know, we had Todd Hendrickson, who is a researcher right now, looking into it, and he hasn't found anything that matches it completely yet. He's still looking. He's still researching, but no one can come up with it. But you'll see, if you see some of the pictures in the book, I mean, he put the symbol everywhere. So it was his mark.
Wow, that's very interesting. That's really one question I had, and art times like this, it really makes me miss Father Malachi Martin hearing this kind of story.
All right, thank you very much for the call, and take care. This is just an odd night all the way around. Hello there, you're on the air with Deborah.
Hello?
Hello.
Hi. I just wanted to say that in your picture where you're supposed to have the mouse or whatever, right behind that machine that says Denon, it looks like the little mouse is looking at you from underneath the white wire.
No, no, no. Okay, so if you see the Denon machine, right? And then there's another machine on top of it with a whole bunch of white buttons, right?
Yes.
That's where it was standing.
And if you look right behind, there's like a little white square on there, like the left.
Yeah, it's an LCD.
Right behind that.
The little white square is an LCD display, and he had his feet on that. He was just sitting there. She was just sitting there staring at me, just staring at me, kind of like Debbie said the rats were staring. Seriously.
Right behind that, underneath the twisted black and white wire, it looks like there's something furry.
Well,
so I think it's the mouse.
I don't think so. Trust me,
okay.
I've been doing nothing but looking. It's not there now. But thank you for the call.
Okay. Thank you.
Take care. That sounded like a youngster, proving my point that we get them all the time. Chaz, hello. You're on the air with Deborah.
Hey, Art. This is Chaz calling from Vegas.
Welcome.
Hi, Deborah. Good evening. I have a quick question for you. I know I've heard a lot of people who deal with this type of thing mention that the more you talk about it, the more type of power you give it and you acknowledge it and, you know, welcome it and that type of thing. And I know you'd mentioned that you weren't really worried about it coming back. I mean, it could be a possibility. What would you do? How would you handle it if it did come back?
I truly believe with my whole soul, it can't come back here. It won't come back, and it can't come back here. It's gone from here. It's still out there somewhere, tormenting someone, but it's not going to be me or my family.
Oh, well, let's hope it's not out there. Let's hope it's gone for good.
Did you, caller, get to see the photographs?
I did. You know, the one with the mirror and the writing on the mirror?
Yeah.
It looked like a flash from a camera, so that was kind of hard to see. And she admitted it was like the reflection of the kitchen and not the bed or the bathroom.
No, I think she's talking about another picture, perhaps. Are you?
Yeah, you know, it's a different picture. There's one that, if you had the book, it's on nearly the last page. It's a really good picture. And it shows the kitchen.
Okay.
And it's like, how can this be? It's in the being taken in the bathroom.
Wow. Well, the one of the bed was, that was pretty wicked, man.
Yeah, that's kind of like out of any horror movie you could name. All right, Chas, thank you very much, and take care. Let's go to, how about Benton, Arkansas on the phone? Hello.
Hi, this is Joseph. This is a first-time caller. How you doing, Art?
Very well, Joseph. Thank you for calling. Great to have you.
Well, yeah, it's great to be on the show, man. I really like it. I was going to ask Debbie, though, did you ever have anybody like a ceremonial magician, anybody that did things like that, that drew
pentagrams
or anything?
Yes, we had.
Did that work at all?
Nothing worked. Matter of fact, Mr. Entity would make fun of them when they left. Or if they left anything around, like some witches would come and they'd leave candles. You turn around and Mr. Entity would take the candles and throw them in the swimming pool. We had all kinds of religious objects and candles in the bottom of the pool.
Okay. Well, I was just wondering that because I've actually seen that work before. And I don't know if you're familiar with Robert Monroe or the Monroe Institute.
I am.
No.
Sometimes it's hard to tell if this is just an astral being that's stuck and angry, or is it really a demonic deep part of our consciousness, like an evil part of us all, because really the spirit world is a part of every one of us. So that's just my belief anyway. So maybe,
you know what I can tell you honestly? I don't know really what it was. I just know it was very evil, and it was a very destructive thing.
Scary enough not to think about it, huh?
Yeah, it is. I just let it go.
I must say, you bet, sir. You held up so well, Debbie. I mean, so really well. I'm amazed. I would not have held up that well, I guarantee you. In fact, this stupid little mouse just has me going now. And so if I were to see something like the picture you have up there of the bed up on end, impossible, absolutely impossible, I'd run. I would run, and I wouldn't stop running until I thought I was far away from whatever was happening, but you didn't have that option. I don't know.
It was running right with us.
Yeah, exactly. So you had no options left. All right, hold it where you are. Everybody, all those lines are full. We have a Skype availability always, so you can try that. In North America, we're MITD51. That's MITD51. Outside the country, outside North America, MITD55. And, of course, our national number, when we get some free lines, 952-225-5278. And we'll give you the first-time caller line when I come back.
Midnight Matters are best handled by those that understand how to move in the darkness, like Art Bell. To call the show, please dial 1-952-CALL-ART. That's 1-952-225-5278.
What a night. All right, that's our national number. Skype, of course, at MITD51 or 55 outside the country. And our first time caller line. I always forget to give that out. It's area code 775-285-5800. That's area code 775-285-5800. If you have never called the program before, Deborah Moffitt is on here with about the best horror story I guess I've ever heard, including photographs, which you can see on artbell.com, and you can make your way over to her site and see many more. It was a six-year odyssey of sheer terror with knives and spears, and dogs ripped in half, and oh, you name it, it happened. Let's go to Matt on Skype. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Aaron here.
Good morning.
Matt from New Orleans.
New Orleans.
Yes,
hey, I should add, we are, by the way, we're working real hard on WWL in New Orleans.
Yes, I read that, and that's going to be unbelievable. That's going to be great. Big monster WWL. You can hear it all the way into North Louisiana.
So I've heard, yeah.
Great entertaining show tonight. I just had a couple real quick questions, Deborah. Did anyone ever see the Mr. Entity doing his writings on the mirror?
No. Or was it never would write in front of you. You had to turn your back or leave the room for a minute and come back.
And I may have missed this earlier, but was there ever any smell? I don't know why through the whole show.
Yeah.
Just smell like old spice.
Like I said before, there were a lot of those things. We had the smells, smelled like rotting food, rotting flesh, noises, poundings. I remember the night before the shamans came to the house, the whole night it pounded on the walls in the beat of like the war, boom, 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 boom. You know, and the entity, it knew the entities, the shamans were coming the next night, and it pounded like that the whole night before they came. So we had all that.
All right. Thanks a lot, Art.
You're welcome. You know, I can smell something odd now, too. I wasn't even going to mention that, but something smells a little different or weird in here. I think what it is I've been psychologically traumatized by Abby Normal and your story. Convinced that's what it is. All right, let's go to the phone, and I think Washington Silverdale. Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
I wanted to say I truly believe everything you've said, but what I'd like to encourage you to do for future research people. Because in the past we've had extraordinary stories and there's not enough research been able to be done, and somebody will, pass away or family members pass away, and then we're kind of, the community of researchers are just kind of left with hearsay, you know, because there was no proof.
Boy, she sure had a lot of researchers there, ma'am.
She sure did. Yes, she did. That's not what I'm getting at.
And you know what? I still welcome anyone who'd like to research it. I'm open to telling them just what happened, showing them everything.
Of course.
I would like answers myself.
What I'd like to encourage you to do for two reasons is that situation where the woman had died and or been killed and placed in a rug.
Yes.
You know, in that situation, while you still remember the dates and the woman's name and identification enough that you knew about her and the individual that she was living with, if you'd call the cold case detectives in that area and just give them a little information, and then that way there's been some kind of not that I don't believe that this entity could have done that, but you've helped with that situation, case that woman's family and that you've helped with that, but also in the future that gives validation that you've done everything you can to isolate that out of the realm of her being murdered by a person.
Sure.
And I think those kind of things, while that's still available, that could,
ma'am, understand, ma'am, understand, that murder could have been committed by a person. I mean, there was domestic abuse going on there, so
very definitely.
Definitely.
And so, you know, not to say that individual that could have murdered her couldn't have been attacked by this entity and caused it, caused the person to do it, too. So
right.
I truly believe everything you've said, but that would even validate your efforts to try to push this forward, because I do believe everything you've said, and I think you're right on the trail. But those kinds of researches tell, you know, and you've done everything you can. You're a very brave woman, I'll tell you. And I don't think you have any alternatives, but you're incredible. So thank you so much.
Right, thank you. Yes, 6 years. There's no way to get away from it. There's no way to run away from it. There's no way to stop it. And God knows she had everybody in there. A lot of people you know and I know tried and didn't have any luck with it. So let's go to, I don't know where it is, but on the phone, you're on the air.
Hi, Art.
Hi.
Thanks for taking my call. I have a few quick questions for Deborah, and then I can take my answers off the air. Number one, did anyone at any time demand to know the identity of this entity?
Yes.
And did it ever identify itself?
As Prince.
Oh, okay. What part of California did this happen in?
The Rancho Cucamonga area.
Okay, thank you. I know it well. Also, other than the 5-foot head with the horn coming around the top of the head, did the entity ever show itself to anyone?
It just showed itself as blackness to my mother-in-law, like black cloud. Twice it chased her.
It was a cloud, not an actual like type of form.
No, she said it was more like a blackness.
Okay, well, good luck. I hope it doesn't return to haunt you anymore, and I give you kudos for what you put up with for 6 years. You're a
Thank
very
you.
Strong woman, Deborah. You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, apparently it doesn't respond well to a cross or a Bible or a religious artifact of any kind, right?
It used to. What it did to all her statues, her religious statues, it would snap the heads off, and it would also... on the cross, and it would also break off the left arm. It had a certain thing it did. Snapped heads and broke off every left arm.
God, this is a scary story. I just don't know how you made it through, but you had no choice again. So, still, you kept a very level head. I mean, as I hear you talk about it now, it seems like you did keep a very level head.
Yeah, I did. I, you know, and if you probably heard this story from my mother-in-law's or my husband's perspective, it'd probably be a lot scarier. Because I was not really, I was frightened for my family, what it could do and to them.
Of course.
That's what I was frightened for. But I wasn't frightened of it. It was almost like, it's okay, I know it's not going to hurt me. I have to be here to protect them.
Uh-huh. All right, well, I'm let's go to the phones. Down to San Antonio, Texas. Hello there.
Well, hello.
Hi.
Thanks for taking my call. I've enjoyed your show for years.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I really mean it, too. I can't, you know, for the first hour and a half or 2 hours, I've been listening to, you know, you and Deborah talk.
Right.
And at first, I am the eternal skeptic, and I'm going like, oh, really? Oh, come on. But now that I've heard her entire story, I'm actually kind of creeped out myself. It kind of scared me. I have a very good friend. I'm not going to put her name out on the air, but she has a daughter who seems to attract these things too. And I was never there to actually see these things, but I've known this woman for like 20 years, and I don't think she would really exaggerate about things like chairs moving in her kitchen and stuff. So even though it took me a while to kind of really get into what Deborah was saying, I you know, like a lot of the callers, I'm actually amazed that Debbie, you were able to actually put up with this for so long.
Except there was no choice. And I, you know, I keep saying the same thing, but there was no choice because this thing followed her. It wasn't in the house. It was after her mother-in-law. So There was no choice. It followed them, no matter where they would go. Even if they went out for the night, it followed them. So imagine the horror of that. For 6 years, I can't even imagine. You know, this is a freaky story, and I don't get scared easily. Tonight, I don't know why, Debbie, but this scared me.
You know what? Mr. Entity was a very, very evil entity. He was evil.
Yeah, well, it wanted to kill.
So you actually really do believe in, like, there's evil out there. I mean,
I lived with it. I know it exists.
Wow. Okay. There are bad humans and there are bad whatevers, but evil.
I mean, think about it. Caller, think about it for a second. If it was you and this thing began to attack and communicate with you, and it wouldn't matter who you called in, priests, people who were really good, like Evelyn Paglini, the Warrens, with this type of thing, they could do nothing. There was nobody who could do anything, and you were night and day. This thing was with you, and there was no way to get rid of it. Now, that's frightening.
Well, you know, I do a lot of reading, and I'm not overly religious, but what I have learned is that if you're really in that much of a bad situation, I don't think there really is much that a human being can do about it. And that's when you have to call upon whoever you believe in, you know, God, Jesus, whoever, and you've got to ask them to come in and help you. And
they
and
did that. They had a priest in there.
Yeah, I know. Obviously the wrong one.
My mother-in-law prayed continually. I think her strong belief in God is what got her through this.
Huh.
Because she believed that eventually God would win. So goodness would win. So I think that's what actually kept her sanity through this, was her strong belief in God.
I have a quick question, Deborah. Why not call another priest? I mean, if the first priest...
We tried other priests.
And?
We went to other priests, and they would say, we have to get permission from the bishop to do this.
Oh, yeah.
It was a time when it was almost like the Catholic Church was trying to poo-poo things like this going on.
There was that period, actually, with the church.
Yeah, it was like they didn't want to address the situation. So that's what happened. I mean, we tried other priests.
Okay. Anything else, caller?
Well, there is one thing. You were talking to the young one about the picture on of the tenon.
Yes.
And I've been looking at it, and if you look at the LCD, and just above the LCD and below the white and black wires.
Yes.
It does look like there's a mouse hiding there.
It's not. It's not, though. It's
Was it like a rag or something? Or?
That's just a what's called a ferrite. It's a ferrite on a cable.
No, like where the twist is, or
it's right below the black and white wires. It's actually sitting on a ferrite, which is a kind of a round thing. So trust me, it's not a mouse.
Okay, but I can sure understand where the youngling came through.
Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Art. I appreciate your time.
You're very welcome. Let's go to the phone and say hello. You're on the air.
Hey, Art. This is Josh from Dallas.
Hey, Josh.
At first when I heard this, I sort of ran everything through my head, and I think the thing that really got me, I just went on your site, and I looked at the book and the symbol that is on the book. Now, was that the symbol that Deborah had been shown by this entity?
Yes, it's a triangle with a tail, and he put that all over. He even carved it into our car.
Aye, aye, aye.
Have you ever heard of an Iblis?
No.
That is the symbol of the Iblis jinn.
What is that?
It is spoke about in the Hadith. I saw that exact symbol whenever I was in Afghanistan in 2010.
Can you spell that for me?
Really?
Can you spell that, please?
Iblis.
Okay.
It is the third type of jinn. That is why you saw smoke. That is why you had certain smells.
Now, does it smell like water? Because this one had a lot of control over water.
Yes, they are, I guess is the term people would know it as, they're elementals. You had the Iblis, the third kind, are rooted to one area but are capable of moving about. The other type, the second type, either takes the form of a dog or a snake. And because I was doing some quick research looking into that spear coming from the Congo, 200 years ago in the Congo, King Leopold II had taken over that area and was cutting off hands of people who were not acting, weren't working fast enough. That place holds like $50-60 trillion worth of minerals. And we're even here recently, the elected president in the Congo had been executed in the United States, and Belgium had been accused of causing their president of being ousted.
All right, very quickly, in Islam, Iblis is a jinn who refused to bow for Adam. Does that sound familiar?
Yes, that is what this is.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very, very much for the call.
That's fascinating.
And I guess you're going to have to look it up, Deborah, and see if you can find the symbol.
Yeah, I will, because no one's ever been able to find that symbol.
Okay. Well, I'll be looking, too. One last caller, if we have the time. Hi.
Hi. My name is Sean. I'm in Austin, Texas.
Hey, Sean.
Okay. So, oddly enough, the guy that was just on the phone,
yes.
I'm very familiar with what he was talking about, and he kind of took the words out of my mouth. This was definitely a jinn that was interacting with her. Like he said, they come in the form of an animal. And, yeah, I don't really have much else to say because the previous caller just kind of answered everything. But yeah, this was definitely a jinn that was messing with her.
That's pretty amazing. All right, well, thank you so very, very much for the information. We'll research that. We'll look for the symbol. And, Deborah, we're out of time. We just did a whole show. Holy mackerel. Where did the time go? But I think we pretty much got the story out. And I just want to tell you, thank you for unraveling that story here, Deborah.
Thank you so much, Art. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Have a good night, and again, thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. What a night in so many ways. What a night. I wish I could have snapped that picture for you, folks. I'm not going to be over this for a while, actually. Just a mouse. Abby Normal, but just a mouse. From the high desert to all those time zones out there. Good night.